actress. And then I will say a couple words, and then we're going to turn it over to Professor Ballantyne. Shall I start it off? I had a question right away. That performance of Fannie Lou Hamer really brought tears to my eyes. And I'm wondering, was she your favorite, or what was your favorite one to perform?
I love performing Clementine the most.
Yes.
She gets into my spirit. But Fannie Lou was a real challenge, and I am very honored to have played her. I call it the Shakespearean section. So, because there's, you know, it's like a three act with Sojourner being in the middle. So she is definitely challenges and expands all of my acting prowess.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm going to mute myself.
Okay.
Let someone else speak.
Your performance was absolutely amazing. How did you get into the spirit of those characters?
I did quite a bit of research on all of them. Fannie Lou and Sojourner was the ones that were closer to what I knew because of Black History Month, because of the way that my family taught Black history. So Fannie Lou, I knew very well. And also Sojourner, I had read Their Eyes Watching God and a couple of her essays. So they were close to me in knowledge, but not in doing. So I really had to delve into what people said about them, what they said about themselves. And then for Fannie Lou, she was the easiest to sort of get into because there is a plethora of interviews, videos, the speech that you heard is all of that is on YouTube. however, when I first started, YouTube wasn't all that. So I had to go to the library to get all of that information. However, once I did, I just sort of went into the essence of what they believed about themselves and changed different mannerisms based upon that. And their accents, they're all Southern, but except for Sojourner, of course, they're all from the South, but they all have different flavors of the Southern accent. And I think that was my favorite thing to do. Anyone else?
Thank you so much.
Oh, no problem.
May I say something?
Please, yes.
I just really was impressed with that performance and what it brought forth in me in awareness of the women that you represented and the courage that they had. And I just wanted to thank you for just doing a wonderful job in bringing that to life.
Thank you very much. It's definitely my pleasure. I really love playing these women. I love the show. I was mouthing along as I was sitting here watching it because I was like, oh, yeah. So thank you. I really appreciate that.
That was just wonderful. I only really knew Zora Hurston. I teach English at the school here. And well, I feel I've been very expanded in my background here. And I particularly responded to those scenes at the convention and the lack of courage in the Democratic Party in those days and how that still seems to be going on to some degree. We aren't moving fast enough. And it just seems a little bit of a shame that those people that you were representing, that they couldn't have gotten a little more credit in their own lifetime for the courage that they had. I know with Zora Hurston, I think she ended up her life as a house cleaner, if I'm not right, after being really center stage and big, big time. And I always wondered what she thought about that, if that gave her any bitterness at the end that she just had to clean. I mean, nothing wrong with cleaning houses, but that she had to end in such a lowly position compared to how high she had risen in her life.
Yeah, I would say that she probably was very bitter because she had such a great ego. And I don't mean to say that in a bad way. She was just totally and completely confident. She came into the world as this confident person who knew what she wanted to be and knew how she wanted to operate in the world. And it really, she is a prime example of how the world will, you know, just the systematic racism, misogyny, it will beat you down to the ground. And it did a lot of those women back in the day. I think it was, there were many of our sheroes of Black history, in Black history, who ended up just going to be a maid somewhere. I think about Josephine Baker. I, you know, she did it. I think about even in our recent history, the woman who was sang for Phil Spector. I can't believe I can't remember her name. Darlene Love. I'm so sorry. Darlene Love, as she was, you know, the main singer for so many years. And then right at the, you know, at part of her life, that was the only thing she could do. So it is devastating to hear that. But thank God for people like Alice Walker, who brought back Zora's work and bought her, I think she bought her gravestone. I may be mixing up my stories, but who actually just brought her back to life, all of her work. Is there anyone else?
You can ask me anything. I'm from down south and I liked your accent.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Fer.
And I just want to know how long it took you to gather the research and act out like you did.
Well, I got as soon as I got the job, I started studying. And I don't know if many of you are familiar with, you know, the audition process of an actor, but you usually don't know what's going to happen. So beforehand, I was just given little excerpts of each woman. And for Zora and Fanny, I just kind of went off what I knew about them. For Clementine, I just made up I sort of embodied my grandmother because she came off the page like my grandmother. And then for Sojourner, that was the sort of an easier way in because so many people have done her speech or read her speech. So in that moment, I just did preliminary work. But once I knew I had the job, then I went into very, very deep research, going to the New York Public Library, combing through the archives, going to the Schoenberg Center, combing through what people said about specifically Zora, because the Schoenberg Center is in Harlem. So doing the work, and it took about, I think about the time I got the job and the time that was the first rehearsal was about a month. So I would say about four weeks. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does.
Excellent. Anyone else? Anything you want. We can talk about travel.
Okay. I just wanted to say that was such an amazing performance. I was compelled to all of the stories, and I just wanted to say it was such an amazing representation. A lot of those, and I really enjoyed it. So thank you for that.
Thank you, Meredith. Thank you.
I was interested in the artwork, actually.
Clementine, yes.
Clementine Hunter. So I looked it up on eBay, and right now, one of her paintings is selling for $12,700.
Yes, the story we like to tell, and this is absolutely true, was that when she was alive, Joan Rivers was the foremost collector of Clementine Hunter's art. So in her, I'm sure that it's been, you know, now that she's passed away, I'm sure her daughter has most of the art, or perhaps it's gone to her estate or auctioned off. Mm-hmm. So yes, her she got very famous. She's my favorite for a reason. I love all of the other women, don't get me wrong. I love Fannie Lou's tenacity. I love Zora's attitude. But Clementine, for me, really embodies, and she brings about the spirit of you can really do anything. You know, being 50 years old, not knowing anything about art, about colors, about composition, light, nothing, and just picking up a person's trash and saying, oh, I think I can do something with this. And then it's powerful getting somebody as famous as Joan Rivers to notice the art, becoming this great folk artist, getting into the museums. I mean, you know, from the age of 52, oh, my light just went off. I'm so sorry. From the age of 50 to the age of, I would say, 102, she was just painting, painting, painting. She had a, what would you call that? A fourth and fifth act in her life. So yes, you can still buy her paintings. I don't know about eBay. A couple of years ago, there was a little bit of fraud. There was an FBI investigation because people were selling imitations and they haven't found all of them. So I would be careful with eBay. Maybe try her estate in Natchitoches.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. So do you have any other projects that you've done?
Go ahead.
That was it.
not, you know, I'm always performing in the United States. I even performed during COVID, which don't tell me about it. but I just came off of a summer stock gig. I usually do regional theaters. So there's nothing that is like my show. This is pretty much something that I've taken on. The author is Kim Hines. She is a theater practitioner in Minneapolis, Minnesota. And she's an African-American woman who's been in the theater for years, written children's plays, children's stories, and things of that nature for the theater. And the core ensemble I auditioned for, as I told you before, and I've just been with them because their stories are so much fun to tell. Currently, I will say we are preparing a brand new show that's in the same vein as Ain't I a Woman? And that show is called Unbought. And that will span only three women. Shirley Chisholm, which was the first Black woman to be nominated for president. She put herself out there to be, she didn't win, of course, but she is a powerful figure from the 70s. Ida B. Wells, who is very, very influential in the women's movement and in the voting rights movement of the the late 1800s, early 1900s. And Sally Hemings, which I don't know if you know, but it was the an enslaved person who was the sort of favorite of Thomas Jefferson. And it just, we go through all of their stories, much like we did in Ain't I a Woman, in hopes to just bring out these women's story, these women's history, and to bridge the gap between things that are happening today and things that are happening back then. Because quiet as it's kept, it's kind of the same, which is, you know, we have a few more rights, but they are trying to take them away every day, it seems. So that's our new show that we are filming at the end of September, actually.
Good evening.
Hi.
Am I allowed to show my face? It seems so weird.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
It seems so weird talking to my picture.
Hi, Nicole.
Hi, how are you? I just want to say that I absolutely and thoroughly enjoyed your performance. It touched my heart. It touched my soul. As an African-American woman who is 50 years old, I learned so much about my own history tonight. Mm-hmm. For that, I thank you. I'd never heard of Clementine Hunter before, mm-hmm. but she is my favorite. She embodies the spirit of some of my older relatives mm-hmm. from the South, mm-hmm. the spunk, the tenacity. You mm-hmm. captured all of that wonderfully, the different dialects. It was so powerful. And I just want to thank you for doing justice to our history. And I thank you.
Oh, thank you, Nicole. Thank you so much. That really touches my heart. Thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you for coming on.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
I would say one more thing, if I might. With the Texas legislature just being successful in kind of closing down voters' rights. We know what they're doing. Everybody knows what they're doing. Mm-hmm. Must be a little bit discouraging to be no further along than we are in 2021, given the levels of courage that people have displayed. Are you discouraged sometime? Might we regress? Might we possibly regress and not go forward from here?
I don't want us to. I feel very strongly that, yeah, you're right. We could regress because of just the misunderstanding between all Americans about who this country is for. Mm-hmm. I think that we have a violent misunderstanding, and we always have. Mm-hmm. And I think that it does disappoint me that we still have to do and may have to fight in the same way that these women had to fight. That, I have to say, James, is very disappointing because we want... You know, people always say America likes to go two steps forward and five steps back in its history and in its progression forward. But this has become untenable, in mm-hmm. my opinion. And I'm disappointed that we're going to have to fight the way that we used to, or the way that these women have. And I'm also a little bit like tired, mm-hmm. you know, I'm learning from these women. Clementine is my favorite to play, but as far as the falling down 10 times, getting mm-hmm. up 11 or whatever the phrase is, that's Fanny. Mm-hmm. Fanny was like, I will fight until we change something and I will fight to my death. And she did. Mm-hmm. And the fact that we are continuing that is too much sometimes, because, you know, I can now talk to you through a computer in my own house. I shouldn't be fighting for my rights. I should be fighting for something else. Mm-hmm. So that is a little disappointing, but I'm hoping that I'm just hoping that there are too many of us who want the world to go forward for them to continue with this oppression. Mm-hmm. That is my hope. And it is also my hope that we all, this new generation coming up, the, you know, young people, 20 to 30s, that we all figure out a way to have differences and leave each other alone. And let each other be free and let each other be equal, but have the differences. It's not the differences that bring the violence. It's the oppressiveness and the idea that one is hierarchy. You know, there's some sort of hierarchy. One person's way is better than the other. That is an untenable. We can't continue like that. I hope that answers your question.
Oh, it was a wonderful answer. Thank you. Appreciate it.
No problem.
There's a hand up. Creta Howard
Bastick. I can't see anything. Sorry.
Yeah, I know. Creta, do you have
a... I just want to say something to Nicole and also to Ms. Jackson. Nicole, that was so brave, what you said. And just, I think a lot of times there's an assumption that everybody knows and understands African-American history and the history of strong women and everything that they bring to the table. And I was pinching myself over here thinking, I really just don't want to say anything because I want to be super positive. But then I thought, the whole time I listened to these narratives, it made me feel like more and more of the help in society, because I feel like every time I'm asked to do something, I'm asked for this phenomenal input, and I give and I give and I give. But then when it's time to enter positions that don't have anything to do with diversity, or that they don't have anything to do with African-American people, mm-hmm. if it is something that involves power dynamics or something that involves giving me the ability and authority to make the decisions right now, those types of authority are not relinquished. They're not granted, because still there's a position of being the help and having your perspectives and ideas being delivered when they're asked of you, but not when you become the person who sits in the seat of power and who's able right. to do these things. Mm-hmm. And so it was really interesting listening to me about the narratives and how perhaps I thought, were people making connections to the African-American women who they encounter and communicate with on a daily basis? And are you listening to those stories and then connecting them with your behavior and mm-hmm. how you treat African-American women, how you respect or decide to respect their ability to have authority and to hold it and to be held accountable for more than just support work? And so thank you again, Nicole, thank you so much. Thank you so much for your talent and your knowledge and for your contributions and for sharing that with everyone. And I hope that those real experiences that you provided today do more than sit in a seat of theatrical work for people, that okay. that they understand that these stories are representative of what is going on today, and that, yes. that those weren't historical stories. Those yes. are stories of what's happening right now. Those things that were talked about, those are happening today. And so I hope that connection is made, that reality, that we are living this right now.
Yes.
And that that these are stories that were provided, but it's provided and it's told and it's so real. And so I hope people can take that leap in their heads and see that. So thank you again, everybody. And thank you, Kathy and your team, for doing this. This is amazing. Thanks.
Yes, that was beautifully said. Yeah. Beautifully said.
I invite another speaker in a second, Shinnery. So.
Oh, okay. I just want to say that was really beautifully said. And I do hope that people make those connections from the history of everything to the actual Black women that you see every day and that you're treating them with equality, that they, what they say and what they think is as important as what you say and what you think. And you're not putting some sort of hierarchical view on their labor.
Mm-hmm. So
go ahead. Okay.
So you selected, well, the core ensemble selected these women to portray, and they were, and it was amazing. And this kind of ties in, that's why I'm jumping in now, to what you were talking about. I'm curious as to the group in general, how they would have selected an inspirational character, maybe from today, maybe from history, and whether they would have chosen someone else, be it their pastor or Malcolm X or whoever they chose as an inspirational leader who made change that they know about and they want to talk about. So that's sort of an open question to everyone. And then I'm going to ask Professor Ballantyne to answer some of the responses by seeing if people have similar interests, similar ideas of leaders, and similar ideas in terms of the qualities of leadership that you think of when you're inspired by strong voices? So that's an open-ended question to anyone who wants to plunge in and say, like, any figures that might relate to Dr. Ballantyne's knowledge of African-American history and women's history more broadly. So, but Shinnery, I wanted to talk with you, but I just want to, in the interest of time, also open it up to him. So. I feel like calling on someone, Dan. Brian, are you with us? Brian Santana had an idea about this. But yeah, I think he's not here anymore.
I don't think it's quite clear what the invitation here is, Kathy.
So we had a lineup of people who were incredibly inspirational, Jim. And the question I had was, did it bring to mind any other people that you know or that you know historically or in your own life that was inspirational in a similar way, had a strong voice that impacted you?
Just the people that, I mean, I feel like I know in my life, anybody who is African American who has suffered from the way that we treat people in society. I feel like anybody who I know who has had to go through that is just such a powerful person. And they're so much more powerful than we can even imagine because, you know, they've had to overcome a lot of things that a lot of us have not had to overcome.
Yeah. It's me again. Yeah. I will say that, I was born and raised in the North in Connecticut, but my mother's family was primarily from the South and in Georgia. And so I didn't really get to know my family or start going down South until I was a teenager. So I didn't get to experience that culture. And so watching this brought me back to conversations with my grandfather and with the older generations in my family. And I remember my grandfather once saying to me that he hoped that this world would be a better place for me and my children. And it saddens me that I feel like it's not. And I feel like I'm going through some of the same things that he never wanted me to experience. And my children are experiencing things that I never wanted them to experience. And fortunately, I'm not a grandmother yet because I don't want my grandchildren and my future generations to have to go through some of the things that I've gone through in my life. And I will say that, you know, some things are regional, but I believe that things can be overcome by education and by love, right? Because children are taught to be disrespectful and to hate, because we all come out with a sense of love and purity. And I think if we can just all get back to that place that we somehow lose along the way, then this world would be a better place.
I have to say amen.
Yeah, I think that's the case, but I think there's a step before that, that is acknowledging there's a problem in the first place, which I think as a society, we have a real problem with. The United States, the American society in general, has never dealt with the legacy of the Civil War, has never dealt with the legacy of slavery. Yeah, and I mean, look at the arguments we still have. I mean, I teach American history surveys. I deal with lost causerism coming up all the time. You know, it's, you know, coming from students who, in some cases, I mean, I'm not that old. I'm older than I'd like to be, but I'm not that old. And it was taught in my high school. I grew up in Pennsylvania. And you know, because the for the longest time that was, you know, sort of the myths we taught ourselves. And you know, before we can get to those points of, I think, of solutions, we have to recognize, as a society, that is, recognize the problem. And we quite simply have not done that.
Seems like, Dan, when we have such a terrible guilt on our back as white people for what we've done, that it just that really it's just the immense amount of guilt that we have on our backs for the way we as a white race and our ancestors have behaved that make it so hard to begin that process of you know, saying I'm sorry, and that we just don't know how to start. We just, it's just so big that we don't know how to start, is how I'm responding to your thoughts right now. It's just too big. And I'm afraid it'll always be too big. I see our society just breaking apart, as we all see that. And for a good number of our people in America, I can't possibly look at that. I just know that I wasn't part of this, and I just can't look at that. And I don't know. I'm a little pessimistic about if that will ever change.
I'll now say something that's going to sound contradictory, but I don't think it necessarily is. Well, I think you're right. I think that's a big part of it. I also think there's sort of, I don't know if American exceptionalism is the right phrase for it, where we like to think of ourselves as a society as the greatest people on earth, and you know, we're the last best hope of man. You hear, listen to any president's speech ever, right? Listen, you know, look back at our propaganda in the Second World War. You know, we like to think of ourselves that way, and it's hard to keep in the head, right? You know, on the one hand, we're the greatest people in the world. On the other hand, slavery. On the other hand, the dispossession of Native Americans. Yeah, and it's hard, I think, to get people to, or society in general, to sort of make that work. But on the other hand, I don't necessarily think it's insurmountable. I tend to be more of an optimistic, even in these times, about sort of the direction that we're headed. And whether that's blind or not, well, I'll leave that for other people to decide. We do need to have, I think, as a society at some point, I don't know how one gets this started, especially in a society as decentralized as ours is, you know, serious conversations about our own past and looking at how we teach our own history, you know, not so it conforms to anybody's ideologies, but if people just take a good, whole, you know, honest look at things.
Right.
Because yes, we have done very bad things. Yes, we've done very good things too.
I think it's like the idea of breaking down the myths. Yes. We love our myths, and like you said, our propaganda. And I think the hardest thing about family, right, is when you find out the truth about everybody, that they're not as great as you thought they were, you know, and that they've done some pretty horrible things in their lives, even though they took care of you and loved you and whatever. You know, and I think that is what needs to happen, is a lot. Unfortunately, it's a lot of people. It might be too many people in America who need to break down those myths. I don't know. But that is a starting point, in my opinion, you know, and I think that's why one side of our political spectrum is trying so hard to stop people from teaching the breaking down of that myth. And I think that they're gonna continue, because it's the myth that has gained us you know, the most accolades, you know, the police of the world, the savior of the world, even though we've been proselytizing democracy for since we started, and it hasn't worked anywhere we've proselytized. It hasn't worked. we send it out all the time, and we send our troops out to help people do it, and it just doesn't work. So it's one of those, and it's one of those things that I think The myth lives in my mind. Do you know? I have to daily unlearn the idea of America in order to deal with the reality of America. Do you know? So I think that's where it starts, is being able to just teach our children that the myth is not real, but we can still be free. We can still have democracy. We can still have equality, even though this big myth isn't real. Yes, working toward the ideal. Yes.
And I think just we got, you know, and the sort of conversations we who have, you know, if you will, that have the hard part, you know, the part of telling people things they don't want to hear. You know, the thing that the people came up with, that 1776 commission, whatever they called it, the last year, the year before. That was in many ways all about telling a certain subsect of our society exactly what they wanted to hear. You know, facts be damned. And that's a harder thing to break down, especially in the bubble society that we've gotten ourselves in. Yeah, the internet is a wonderful thing. It's, I mean, we wouldn't be here right now without it, but it makes it so easy for us to self-select and hear only what we want to hear. Whereas before, you know, who your neighbors are, you have no control over, right? And though you had to interact with them, and they might be Republicans, they might be Democrats, they might be Catholics, they might be atheists, they might be Protestants, whatever, and you were forced to sort of accommodate to that, but not so good at that anymore. And it becomes a sort of echo chamber.
I don't know if I would say that you, at least people who look like you, did have they could choose their neighbors.
Well,
we have system.
You can choose your neighbors to a degree.
And also, if we look at immigration, not from, you know, the standpoint of whatever we look at it now, but from how it started, you know, everybody had their own neighborhoods.
Right.
Because one person didn't like the other. So you could choose your neighbor. You could, if you were Italian and grew up in a time, go to the Italian section of town, and thrive. So also to your other point, I want to, right now, you know, there's an idea of progression and an idea of what it is to go backwards, right? But also, the other thing that you have to, not have to, but I want to bring up is that before segregation, everybody was on the same page. There were not a lot of progressive white people wanting integration.
No.
They all were on the same, everybody was on the same page. This is how it is. And I think that the more progressive we get, and I even hate saying progressive because it's just fairness and equality. The closer we get to fairness and equality, which I don't want to even say progressive, but the more people are like, wait a minute, no, it's not supposed, there's a separation, there's a hierarchy. There's the people here, and then there's everybody else that we don't think about unless we need something cleaned. So I just want to point that out. The idea that you can choose your neighbor, I mean, you really could, and there were laws.
Well, I just simply meant you don't actually know the person who was next door, and they could, you know, in the sense that you would have to adjust to them.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, what you mean. Yeah, that's
what you mean. Sorry about that. Yes,
yeah, no okay. problem. No, that's, I understand. That's a very good point. Mm-hmm.
Can I read the chat room a little bit? Because I love it. it brings us back to Zora Neale Hurston and Their Eyes Were Watching God, and choosing American, African-American literature in your American literature courses and expanding people's awareness. And I think this night has really expanded our awareness of Zora Neale Hurston. And I'm wondering how you felt about her voice in a time when people didn't have rights and she stood up for herself, and then was ultimately, as Professor Rolston said, kind of swished down, but died ignominiously until Oz Walker discovered her. But do you think that just writing is an answer? I'm kind of addressing Shinnery because I see her so clearly. And she portrayed her so well.
Yeah, Zora, you know, she was, I said this already, but she came out completely confident. She had nothing to prove to anyone. She knew she was the best writer there ever was. She knew that she was, you know, and it wasn't an ego thing. It wasn't like a narcissistic idea of that. It was just like, this is who I am, and this is how I've been nurtured. And then came to New York, ironically went from the South to the North in mm-hmm. order to be then hit with misogyny in the, you know, Harlem Renaissance.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then to be hit with, you know, and you're a Black Southern lady who talks a certain way. Don't come up here with that dialect. You need to learn the King's English or whatever. So mm-hmm. I think that it is not a detrimental idea to her, it's our society. And that's the other thing I want to say. It's very easy to go, oh, these Black people were so sad and they suffered, and oh Lord, they had so much suffering. And I think it is another horrible tool of racism to blame the victim every time. You know, mm-hmm. you went through so much suffering. You're so strong. You must be. There was no other. Mm-hmm. The other people were putting their boot to our brain,
yeah.
killing us every day. There was no other choice but to fight that and to make sure that what they believed in, this myth of equality and everybody created equal, that they meant it, and to fight to put it in front of their faces every single day on the local level, on the grand level, and to ask, do you really mean this? Because if you do, great. If you don't, you need to check yourself. You need to look in the mirror and say, I want to be racist. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, this is who we are. And Zora was constantly, just by being who she was, inadvertently or directly challenging that system.
Mm-hmm.
Are we here for intellectualism to raise the Black race from what they think we are? Or are you just here to make sure that your, you know, talent in 10th succeeds, leaving everyone else that you think is too dumb, too this, too that behind? You know,
mm-hmm.
she was like, there is an intelligence and there is a gift in these folk, you know, the folk yes. songs and the way that we talk. There is a poetry in the dialect, whereas everyone else, ironically, especially the people she was hanging out with in the Harvard Renaissance, were like, we're trying to go up.
Yes, so and I hate to say it, but the men particularly.
Yes, definitely. Yes, she was one of the only women, you know.
Yeah.
They ran everybody else out.
Yeah.
And you didn't have that, the Toni Morrisons and the Jamaica Kincaids and Alice yeah. Walkers, and you didn't have a cadre of Black women who were writing. Sonia Sanchez, you didn't have that back in the Harlem Renaissance, because everybody was just trying, you know, their best to be I don't even know. I don't want to put a label on it, but there was no women's collective for her to sort of move to. It was just like, mm-hmm. this is the best of the best. These people are the iron that will sharpen my iron. I know that I'm a genius. I know that they're geniuses. They're working in the way that I want to work. I deserve to be in this room. And she never she never, unlike the other women in the show, she never had that, you know, that oppressive thing that most Black people walk around with, do you know? The sort of like, I'm gonna fight, but I know that they're gonna say this, that, that, that. She never had that. She was just like, of course I'm a genius. What are you talking about? Yeah. Of course I've read Socrates. Yes, and I know how to quote it. And I can, not only can I, do I know Socrates, but I can directly link the way that he patterns out whatever, you know, I'm saying Socrates, but it could be anybody, yeah. Plato or whoever, Aeschylus. The way that they pattern out their poetry directly to the folk songs and the way that my uncle patterns out his songs. The two are linked. But nobody, they were just like, oh, ha, ha, ha. You're a good time girl. Let's have some fun and whiskey, you know. So anyway, that's how I feel about Zora, to sort of answer your question.
Yeah, I'm a huge Zora fan, so I wouldn't.
I love her. Yeah, me too.
So in the interest of time, I think we should just wrap it up with anybody having any last questions to Professor Valentin or to Ms. Jackson, or anyone want to say any parting remarks? I just want to thank you so much for the core ensemble, and thank you, Dr. Valentin, for your input about the sort of historical pushes that we encounter. And I did want to thank, I have to thank a few other people. So I close tonight with final thanks to all those involved, the audience who made the discussion rich and worthwhile, the core ensemble featuring Shinnery Jackson, the West Virginia Humanities Council, who sponsored the event along with the college, Brian Santana, our contributing expert scholar, Dan Valentin, the professor facilitating tonight, and the folks who marketed and produced it. I'm getting into the credits here, and they're great. Jessica Leek was our graphic designer. Sarah Shade made the website. Kelsey Springer, our technical host and helper with all things logistical to make the night go smoothly. I also wanted to thank Brett Gallagher, Dean of Professional Studies and University Transfer, who supervises the Humanities Division, and Jen Barrett Smith, who supervises marketing, for their support of me and us and the marketing production side. Finally, please take 2 or 3 minutes now to complete our survey that the sponsors, the West Virginia Humanities Council, asked us all to complete following the event. It's very short, and it is, Kelsey, is it in the chat? I hope Kelsey's there.
Yes, I've put the survey in the chat with the link, if everybody can just take a minute to take that.
And I also have it, you have their registration, right? I can send it out by email as well.
Yes.
Perfect. And thank you. I already said thank you, but thank you, Shinnery. I think that's closing.
Thank you for having me.
Okay. And that was great. Thank you for staying on too, because
it was wonderful to talk to Dan. This was really a great discussion.
Yeah.
I want to take a class, Dan. Yeah, this was a great discussion. Thank you very much.
Yeah. He has a whole lecture, FYI, in our website. So if anyone hasn't checked it out. I'm just gonna stay on for a second, see if anyone has any final thoughts.
Thank you once again, and blessings to you. Thank you for bringing this to our community. It was a wonderful, open, honest discussion. So I greatly appreciate the evening.
Well, you were an awesome participant, Nicole, and thank you so much for your sharing.
Well, thank you. My heart is full. So now I'm going to go have, some ice cream or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
Have a good night.
Okay, good night.
Bye-bye.
Bye. I feel like CJ isn't.